We're trying to name what Evan's producer cam is, okay? Oh, I just threw Evan hole out there.
He called it the Evan hobby hole.
Yeah, the Evan. But if you have a better name for what we should call.
Yeah, absolutely a better name than Evan hobby.
You must have a better name. Welcome back to the break room, everybody. Today, we're getting real industry with it by talking about the current details of the new SAG agreement, the contract. I'm Zach Huddleston, and joining me today, two SAG members, Jay Washington and Marina MAstros.
Hi, everybody.
Wow, welcome. They're gonna give us the inside scoop from working actors on what this new agreement means. You know, hard fought, well-deserved agreement, all the negotiations with the AMPTP, back and forth. And particularly, we're gonna talk about like what this could mean for the kind of content we love and are consuming and the people who make that content, more importantly. Mm-hmm. So I think one of the biggest conversation topics, for the outside world at least, about this strike was AI. Mm-hmm. That was the big buzzword.
Internally as well, don't worry.
Yes, yeah.
Oh yeah.
And particularly like how AI is impacting art, how it will continue to impact art going forward, what's allowed to happen with AI, and for SAG, of course, how that impacts actors. So we have to be very specific here because there's a lot of interesting industry definitions here. So, and Evan and Dashiell have put together some cool graphics. I think these were provided by SAG. Is that right, Evan?
Yeah, these are all from the SAG-AFTRA website.
Okay, great. So these are things they've provided publicly to kind of explain everything. And so we're gonna just quickly define, there are two types of AI performances that have been defined under this new SAG agreement. And so let's talk about them real quick. The first one, the employment-based digital replica. Doesn't that sound sexy as hell? So this is basically, you know, you show up to work as an actor, you're scanned, and maybe some part of your performance will be AI altered. I think a very recent, very prominent example of this would have been Nicolas Cage's performance in The Flash, when he shows up as Gumby Superman fighting a giant spider. So Nicolas Cage did work on The Flash. He showed up to a studio at some point and they scanned him, but none of the image that showed up on screen was Nicolas Cage, right? All of that was computer generated, whether AI was involved or not, that was all computer generated. So like that performance would have fallen under this employment-based digital copy. The other definition, Evan, can you pull up the other? Is an independently created digital replica. So basically the big difference here is you never showed up to set for this one. Mm. This is created based on something else. Maybe you've been dead for 50 years and they used old pictures of you. Maybe you just gave consent for them to put together a Marina MAstros composite based on Instagram photos, whatever, right? Like, I think some of this will be defined as we move forward with technology, but.
Yeah, this is basically like, if I, on my own, outside of any SAG production whatsoever, want to create a digital copy of myself and then license it out.
Right.
I can do that on my own and make money on my own, which is probably, I think, what a lot of big stars will eventually do. It'll probably be common practice.
Yeah.
As much as it's pushback right now, Marina's absolutely right. Because you're going to have stars be like, well, I can't do all these projects at one time.
Mm-hmm.
And they want to do all these projects at one time. Mm-hmm. You're going to have, this is going to take away from my career. Well, now I can be in 5 movies at one time.
Well, and Evan and I were talking about this before we shot. And I think one way, and we'll kind of bring it back to fandom here and the content we consume. Like, Marvel movies, all giant blockbuster movies, famous for their reshoots, right? Sometimes the reshoots take almost as long as the initial shooting, right? Much later. Can you imagine a world where, like, Deadpool 3 is coming out next year, fingers crossed, right? They need to do some reshoots. Hugh Jackman is busy on Broadway, right? So the two potential outcomes are, cool, the movie gets delayed another 3 months.
Yeah.
None of us get to see Deadpool 3 for that much longer while he has other contractual obligations. Or maybe we get 5 seconds of AI Hugh Jackman Wolverine, you know, that maybe we never even notice in the flow of watching that film, right? Like, don't we as fans win? And Hugh Jackman's still getting paid.
We're going on the same amount.
Yeah. And the art that the director and the creators of that film want to make still gets still gets made.
Never forget, you got an AI Ryan Reynolds in the first one. Second one, as the Juggernaut. Juggernaut is Ryan Reynolds in the second one. So all the thing is with the contract, more so anything, there's actually language and terminology in it. These things have, for the most part, been done.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
There are background extras who were scammed doing Book of Boba Fett and then were used on other things.
Mm-hmm.
So all this stuff has been happening. It's not just a, oh, it's coming. It has been here. It has been done. It's just now, because of the time when it came in and became prominent, by the time our contract came back around, now you can actually put language in the contract to deal with it. So when you have a lot of people who are pushing back again, like, well, you shouldn't use it at all. They've been doing it.
Yeah.
Yeah, and now this is just like kind of putting a framework and some kind of rules that they have to abide by. And those rules mainly get the people paid, right? Whose image is being used. Yeah.
And Hugh Jackman theoretically would have to consent to a description of what it will be used for. So it's too broad to say, okay, he's going to be in Deadpool, period. That's too broad. They have to actually describe.
Yeah, what we're using
him
for.
Yeah, so they couldn't do it, like, put him in a weird sex scene that he would never agree to do
exactly,
with his actual body or something
like that. You sure of that?
And maybe he would consent to a weird sex scene.
You know he's one of his best friends, right?
I mean, hey, and if you're in great shape, why wouldn't
just be in a weird sex scene just like this.
But and that's important, right? And so they'll be like, oh, we're going to, you know, put you in this frame doing, you know, this positioning or whatever. And he'd be like, cool, sounds great. I'm going to keep singing on Broadway. You guys run with that. He can literally be in two places at once, and that benefits everybody that consumes the content he makes, right? In theory. Again, especially if everybody's getting well compensated for it. It also makes me think of, like, you see those, like, Japanese commercials where, like, Brad Pitt selling soda or whatever, you know? Now he doesn't even have to fly to Japan
really
to make those,
Japan.
You know? They'll just do AI Brad Pitt selling Faygo.
There's a whole AI Japanese commercial out right now. And I think, you know what I'm talking about, Evan?
There's
an entire, it's an AI model. And she's amazing. She's beautiful. You think she's real, but they're like, no, she's not. But she's selling a product. It has been happening. You've probably seen it. It's been happening.
Mm-hmm,
yeah.
Mm-hmm.
There's, like you said, now the protections are in place to where you define clearly what you have to do, what you want to do, what you will do, and what you will be able to do with these things. Because there's no putting the proverbial genie back in the bottle.
Yeah.
Yeah. And specifically, that character would fall under, like, the next definition. Dashiell, which is like the generative AI character. So this would be like creating like a full character base, you know, that simulates a performer and stuff like that.
Like a VTuber or something like that,
but like
basically,
more
right?
In depth,
completely synthetic, not based on any human or whatever, right? An invented AI generated character. So who gets paid for that?
The people who have contributed to the generation of that AI ideally would be compensated for that, but that part needs to be regulated by legislation.
Because that's where it's going to get out of hand.
Yeah, because right now SAG doesn't have the ability to regulate that because anybody can do it.
Yeah.
Out in the world.
Deepfakes.
So, yeah, that's essentially what deepfakes are. So we essentially have to lobby lawmakers to regulate that because right now it's happening in an unregulated fashion. Mm-hmm. And you know, and that has implications for everybody, not just actors, moviegoers, anybody who consumes content. You could be walking down the street, someone has a camera. Again, this is like technology that exists but isn't really available in like people's living rooms yet, but it will be eventually. So you could theoretically be walking down the street, someone takes a video of you and goes, oh, you'd look good as like this murderer character in this other thing. And then they're using you without consent. So, or using your movements to generate a character that does that. And then you'll be watching later and go like, those look like my eyeballs.
Because that's what AI is. That's what the AI is, especially with like the AI photos that everybody were doing. It takes from what is already out there.
Yeah.
It pulls from things. So it has to be, you have to be able, like she said, you have to figure out where was the original. But that is federal lobbying because again, this is getting, the deepfakes themselves are getting wild because now you can deepfake somebody's voice.
And it's been a lot of in music, right? Like people doing fake Drake and all this kind of
Let
stuff.
Let me tell you
right?
something. No, listen, I'm so anti. Hear me out. I am so anti AI. However,
Patrick Starr singing R&B songs on TikTok is the greatest thing I've ever heard. Him doing Keisha Cole's Love. Like, I was loving it. But when
this is the problem. Yeah. Everybody says they don't like it, but they love it.
Well, listen to Patrick Starr get vocal, but it's the things of the deep fakes. It's the things of the things you can't control, you can't trace. You can trace where a Patrick Starr singing AI came from. You can do the backtrack when somebody uploads it and things like that. But with all these other things, you have to. That's why governments, world governments, are getting involved with this. Like, yo, this is getting serious because someone can impersonate a world leader.
Right. You could put out.
It didn't occur to me.
And people just right, like there's stuff of like Joe Biden saying stuff he never said in person, right? But you could make him say anything you wanted, right? And that there's a lot of danger there. And I think, you know, something I saw come out of like the WGA agreement was, you know, of course we don't know where some of this stuff is going to go. Like all technology, nobody can perfectly predict 10 years from now. It's important to at least get a foothold in these spaces. Mm-hmm. And then the next contract, you renegotiate based on where the technology's gotten since the last one, right? Like that's how all of these work. And it's important that you just got some of the initial language documented and the definitions that then we can build off of in the future, right?
Mm-hmm. And then next renegotiation is in 3 years, which is very soon.
Yeah.
Did you guys, I don't know if this is off topic too much, but did you guys see that Netflix got sued by a guy whose picture they took off of Instagram? And they put it into a show about a murderer, a documentary about a murderer, an axe wielding murderer, and then it's a picture of this guy on Instagram holding an axe. They use it. I swear this is real. Look it up. And his friends start texting him like, "Hey, bro, did you murder someone? Because you're in a documentary about an axe murderer with a picture of you literally holding an axe." And he was like, "No, I did not. What the hell?" And so he sued Netflix for just like using his image. And that's not even AI. That's just wildly...
Just bad research.
I'm not even... It's not I swear you. It's right.
Because Netflix... Look, I have friends who work at Netflix. I will say they are good people.
Totally.
But the company... They're the reason we were held up so much with this anyway.
And we're going to talk about... So the next big topic is just streaming in general, how people get compensated when they do work on streaming services. And there's some really interesting stuff there. First, I want to shout out two quick things. We have a live show this Thursday on Fairfax in LA at Brain Dead Studios. There's that cool graphic. Come out and see us if you're going to be in Southern California. We're going to have a really good time. And then I want to shout out like this shirt I'm wearing, Later Gators, which check out the back of this shirt.
Ooh, very nice. Like the
best part. Later Gators.
Our cool merch over at nerdriot.shop. We just put out just on Friday, we put out a new Loki shirt that producer John helped design.
What did he do? Oh, I didn't see that one.
Stories.
Very cool.
Based on the finale of the series. And a lot of people have been grabbing that. Check out that, all kinds of other, we've got some
You got
cool.
the Flarkin one up there? You have the Flarkin one.
There it is. Great. Whether you're just a cat fancier or a fan of the Marvels or both, you can grab that shirt. Nerdriot.shop. So one of the other big things, unless did we miss anything on AI, Evan?
No, I think we
talked a little bit about like background actors.
Oh, yeah.
And, you know, when there's a giant crowd scene in a movie, it's rough to try to hire 70,000 people, right? And throughout Hollywood history, they usually get like a chunk of people and either have them move sections
as the camera moves,
or they fill in, you know, either with CGI or cardboard cutouts or whatever. But there is some now that AI technology can, you know, even more accurately replicate human beings and backgrounds. There's some new language in this agreement to compensate people who act as the basis for those replication, right?
Yeah.
Listen to what you said. I'm sorry to cut you off.
No.
You just said CGI, and then we go to AI. That's the evolution of it.
Yeah.
That's the legit evolution of it. Like, you knew it was coming eventually. Mm-hmm. So I just wanted to make sure I clarified that for people to understand. We've been saying these certain things without saying them. We've been talking about artificial intelligence and doing these things when we say computer-generated images. They're the same thing. They go hand in hand.
Mm-hmm. AI is a tool manipulated by the digital creators.
Yes.
Yeah.
Which for a skill that they've already been
doing. And like a lot of the de-aging technology we've seen in a bunch of movies and series and all this kind of stuff, it is like the marriage of the existing computer technology with now AI can do it a little bit more efficiently, a little better. Right?
We have a question from the Evan.
from the yeah, other section.
Still no way, no good way to do this. I just got to raise my hand.
Well, we as soon as we have language for what this is called,
we're not calling it your hole, Evan.
The chat really wants to call it the hole.
Evan's hidey hole.
I think just Evan's.
Whoa, hole. Evan's hidey hole.
I think something interesting about the digital alterations is here in this language is producers will provide a reasonably specific description of the intended alterations. Yeah. Like, do you think this is something that used to happen? Like, do you think anyone was like, oh, maybe we should clear like how many wrinkles we're going to get rid of on somebody or like how many?
Absolutely not.
Yeah, yeah.
No, so. And there's a long history of that not happening, right? I mean, famously, I don't know why this is, I just listened to a great podcast series called You Must Remember This, where it was talking about, they did a whole series called Sex in the 90s. It was about like how sex was portrayed on films in the 90s. Like Sharon Stone in that super famous Basic Instinct scene did not know they were going to show up her skirt until she saw the movie. She did not know that, right? And so like consent with actors and how they are portrayed on film is a long running, controversial thing. And like, and that was like, she was the star of that film and she didn't necessarily have the leverage. I think like once she saw, she could have fought and she realized like, this is not the fight I want to have. Whatever, you should go listen to that podcast to get more of the details on that. But like, even when you're a star and you have leverage, right? It is still a challenge. And so like you need your union, right, to set precedent here so that you don't have to, you know, that every individual actor doesn't have to have these fights, right? That they have an agreed upon group of rules to back them up.
Okay, I'm gonna say the worst devil's advocate statement ever in regards to this.
It's a discussion.
It's the worst, I'm prefacing it for everyone.
You know what it is.
It's the worst devil. It actually enhanced the movie, that scene,
That's probably why she didn't fight it.
Yeah.
Because let's just be real, that scene is one of the most iconic scenes in Basic Instinct.
Mm-hmm.
And I know everybody's like, well, they didn't. Yes, I get that part. I understand. It is hella bogus. Like, the director's like, make sure you get it.
Yeah, oh my God.
Yeah, he did. And the irony is she might have agreed to do it anyways, but they didn't ask because they didn't want to risk it, which that is the wrong thing to do.
Absolutely. That's what I'm saying. It's the wrong thing to do. Yeah. Sorry, Zach. But
this language in this contract is like, we'll just ask, right? Mm-hmm. Like, hey, man, let's have these conversations. Let's agree to it. And even if it's not my body you're going to be doing something with, it'll be a digital AI version of my body. Like, I have to be cool with it.
Yeah.
And, you know, for people outside of the film industry where it's like, why do I even care about this? It's less that it's like, everybody needs to consent to this and because it's just like what we want as people in SAG.
Mm-hmm.
It's more, it's just gives people an option, an informed option. So it's not saying if you are going to be a background actor, you have to consent. It's just saying if you want to consent, great, we'll hire you. If you don't want to consent, you don't have to do it.
And it won't, they say sometimes, now there's language supposedly says, well, if you don't consent, you'll lose your job. I really doubt that. It depends, like, you have to be just so egregious with not agreeing to be scanned for something.
Yeah.
Because there was also the argument of, well, what if I'm a background actor, I get scanned, right? Then, who knows, I blow up. So but see, here's the thing behind that. You still have to get consent to use the digital image that was scanned. So if you do blow up as a background actor, for those who may be watching, let's say you blow up, you're a background actor, you got scanned, now you blow up. They can never use your background image without your permission.
Mm-hmm.
So you don't have to worry about being the next Brad Pitt on set with the old Brad Pitt.
I'm just fine.
Looking at yourself destroying the space-time continuum.
Yeah, like, true.
And then another thing, too, that I really like, if lip or facial movements are altered to make it look like a background actor is speaking and dialogue is added, they will be upgraded to a day performer.
Yep.
Because I feel like with the digital alterations, like, it is so easy, especially if you have a background, you like, oh, yeah, we hit our background minimum. We hired, you know, however many people today. But we'll make the one digital person speak. It's like, no, you can't.
Well, and maybe for people watching that aren't as familiar with how acting works, right? Like, you get paid a different rate if you speak lines. It's why when you watch a Blumhouse horror movie, you will never see any background actor ever speak. In fact, I've heard interviews with Jason Blum because they famously like try to make their movies as cheap as possible. Yeah. so that, you know, then mm-hmm. however much money they make, they can afford that risk. Like, you will never see a waiter.
Yeah.
Say like, anything. The waiter will always just drop off food. The waiter will never say, anything else I can get you? Yeah. In a Blumhouse movie. Anyways, because then they have to pay them more. Yeah. But, so yeah, that basically, they can't get around that now with mm-hmm. AI, right? Mm-hmm. Where I didn't pay you to speak, but I'm going to make your mouth move.
And... Yeah, exactly.
Also, speaking words is different than making sounds. So like, for instance, when you see crowd scenes where people are yelling and cheering and mm-hmm. things like that, that does not count. Just so people know, because like, that is completely different from saying, holy shit, did you see what happened?
Yeah.
That's a line.
Yes. Mm-hmm. So then the other, let's chat about the other big thing that both the writers and the actors strikes were thinking about during their strikes were like streaming services, right? The industry has changed so much since their last contracts. Mm-hmm. We're now the majority of content is made for streaming, or at least a giant portion of it. And so many of the historical compensation rubrics by which the industry has worked were based on television or mm-hmm. film, right? And they have not been perfectly adapted to streaming. Things like residuals, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. Where like, if you made an episode of Cheers in 1988, right? Every time that episode of Cheers gets played on TBS or in France or whatever, right? You, you know, get a check for like $1.21 or whatever, right? And you have since 1988. Mm-hmm. Now Netflix, right? If you made an episode of, what was the blockbuster show that came
Stranger
out?
Stranger Things? What do you mean?
House of Cards.
Or I meant the show that was literally about Blockbuster. Or the movie store.
It's probably just called The Last Blockbuster.
Last Blockbuster. Yeah. Anyways, I was trying to think of it. Or that's Stranger funny. Things. Stranger Things being a better example. If you're on an episode of Stranger Things, there is no residual because that only exists on Netflix. You know, there is no such thing as a rerun. People can pull it up anytime they want, right? They're never going to license that out to another service or to TV or whatever, right? So you will never get any residual, even if it is being your episode is being consumed by millions of people 10 years later, right? And so they did some things in this agreement to address that.
There is one show in particular that changed everything for them. It's called Suits.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
People, this many people never watched Suits when it was actually on television.
Yeah.
Yeah. On USA. For on many USA. Years.
Mm-hmm. And now it is one of the highest stream shows in Netflix.
It's been in their top 10 for months.
For months.
And including me.
So many people, you know, consuming Meghan Markle in her pre-royal days. And just glorious suits. All the ties, the jackets, the pants, lots of suits on Suits.
I just know I'm happy about us being able to get better residuals because I am in three episodes of a show that only got one season because our lead went back to being a Punisher. I digress. Out of three episodes, out of an 8-episode season of a cable show, which is now you can barely find some places, I got a residual check the other day for $24.
Yeah.
The new contract hasn't kicked in yet. Yeah. I need this to kick in. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So just so you have an understanding of why you hear actors going, my residuals were nothing. And residuals were something actors live off of because unless you are a major, major name, you're literally job to job.
Yeah.
Yes. And let's talk about that a little bit. So, you know, the math of the entertainment industry has long been presupposed on like, hey, everybody's hoping for a hit. Mm-hmm. Because if something's a hit, film or TV, everybody gets paid, right? And like, you might do a lot of things that are not hits, that don't make you very much money, but hopefully if you stick it out, you'll be in something eventually that turns into Cheers or Avengers Endgame or whatever, right? And then you can continue to survive off of that successful project for a long time. Again, the streaming model did not factor for that. You were not able, even if you are on Stranger Things, doesn't matter, it could be the most popular show on all of streaming in the entire world. You are still getting paid the exact same amount.
Yeah, and what didn't Aaron Paul on the picket line? He was like, "I have no residuals from Breaking Bad going from the original."
Yeah, but when it was on AMC to Netflix, he gets nothing.
To Netflix, he gets nothing.
Even though most people probably consumed that show on Netflix as opposed to its initial cable run, right?
Yeah.
So they created, I think the language is streaming bonus,
yes.
Right? And the definition of this for a high budget. SVOD, streaming video on demand.
Yeah.
Okay. Anything that you can hit a button and start playing. Seasons of series, mini series, and long form pictures. It's long form pictures, I assume, is movies.
Yeah.
Yeah, long form pictures that basically air after January 1st of next year. There's potential for, I know, of course. But hey, for the future,
yeah.
There's a success payment, okay? Due if the viewing time in the first 90 days of each exhibition year is equivalent to the production being watched by 20% or more of the subscribers for that service. So this is some similar language to the WGA. Basically, if you work on a show that is in the top 20%, or no, I'm sorry, no, not in the top 20%, is viewed by 20% of the subscribers of a service.
Within 90 days.
Within 90 days, there's a little bonus, right? And, you know, the amount of that bonus and how that bonus is distributed, yada, yada, we don't have to get into those details, but if you're on a hit, you get a little something extra.
If you're on a hit, you get the majority of that bonus, and then a minority of that bonus gets, which I think is important, distributed to everybody else. Yes. Or it gets put in a pot.
Puts in a pot
that can be distributed to everybody else. So even if you don't love this deal, they are taking steps to create a pot of money that will pay you in the future.
Yes. And so I think this could be, let's zoom out to like how this could impact the content we love going forward.
Yeah.
I think a couple things come to mind for me. You know, whenever there's a Marvel or a Star Wars show out, that is usually at the top of the streaming charts.
Mm-hmm. Totally.
Those shows are probably getting consumed by 20%. And so the people who are making Marvel and Star Wars shows or other gigantic hit streaming shows, maybe The Boys or something like that. Certainly maybe things on Max like House of the Dragon or something. I guess that's a broadcast show. But they're going to be compensated more. So there's maybe more of an incentive for people. Right, Samuel L. Jackson or Jeremy Renner already have plenty of incentive to make these shows. They're being well compensated no matter what. But now other people, right, maybe even more incentivized, I want to be on a hit show, right?
Also, this is part of the, so the reason you get a bonus like this and you do this, 20% of the subscribers, because they don't want to tell you the subscriber numbers. That's what that whole big thing is. You know, Netflix, the biggest argument has been, well, tell us how many subscribers you actually have. They'll never give that number away.
Yeah.
Or how much money my show is generating.
Right. Yeah. They'll never give that money. That money and number.
And some of that, devil's advocate, is those numbers are tough, right? It is. I know they know these internally, but like for instance, Amazon Prime, right? Like they are running their entire video business as like a loss leader to sell more toilet paper and kids' toys or whatever. So it's like, it's hard to be like, how much money did The Boys make for Amazon? Yeah. They don't really give a shit. It's more like how much toilet paper did the people who signed up for Prime to watch The Boys then buy? And then that's weird to pay Carl Urban for the amount of toilet paper sold,
right? Go to Apple Plus.
Yeah, same thing.
Apple Plus, for those who don't know. Apple Plus care. Look, they make you some decent shows. They don't care about them. They're all tax write-offs. Because Apple is a tech company, just as much as Amazon is.
Yes.
But Netflix is a tech company, but it lives and dies by streaming.
Yeah,
that's where all of this really comes into effect play, because it's Netflix saying, hey, we got 280 million subscribers worldwide. Oh, you do?
Yeah.
Okay.
And you know, it's worth talking to here. I know there's probably some really fun people watching this video being like, poor actors, blah, blah, blah. Just give me my Rick and Morty that I can be toxic about or whatever, right? Here's what I'll say.
Season 17.
Yeah, right? Like, and Marina and Jay know this even better, right? The vast majority of people who make the content you love are not Carl Urban or Samuel L. Jackson or...
Yeah, you don't know who we are.
Right.
And, you only know me from now, here.
I can't testify that both Marina and Jay showed up in Bentleys, okay, that were hovering 16 inches off the ground they're using space age hover technology. No.
Don't you put my Jetsons business out here, Jack, goddammit.
That's right. But, right, like, most people that make content are working class, right? And they work incredibly hard to make the stuff that we watch and love, right? And so we want them to be rewarded. And I want people to be incentivized to make great work. Don't you? Like, if this contract made the shows and the movies you love, like, 11% better?
Yeah.
Wouldn't that be a huge win for everybody? Take out the human part of it of you would like people to be able to survive and eat and whatever, right? Like, hey, if your shows are a little bit better because the people making these shows have a huge incentive to make them good and popular, right? Like, that's a win for everybody.
I don't think anybody right now wants to watch entirely digital content that used to be live action.
Yeah.
Like, no one wants to go, I mean, I'm sure I'll be told immediately in the comments that they do want that, but nobody wants to watch, like...
What do you know? You're just a woman.
Yeah, exactly.
Or just some dude sitting in his mama's basement.
Nobody wants to watch a digital Brie Larson when they could be watching real Brie Larson.
Caught comment right behind it. I don't even want to watch the real Brie
Larson. Okay, yeah. No, and even like what is one of the biggest knocks usually on like Marvel or big blockbuster things is like the CGI looks fake.
Exactly.
The thing we like the least about some of these products is when they look digital.
It's going to look better now. It's going to look better and more realistic the more humans are on set.
Right.
And if you really like don't care about us at all, which fair enough, there's an estimate that the strike having been going on for 118 days cost the California economy, which is like the biggest economy in the United States, I think, maybe.
Yeah.
Give me that number.
$13
billion. Oh, I thought it was six.
Oh, the one I read was $13 billion, but I could be wrong.
And it's you might be right.
It's certainly in the multiple billions.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
So even if you don't care about the actual people in the industry, it behooves you to care about the fact that us not getting a good deal impacts the entire economy, and I would argue global economy. Mm-hmm. And if we just do a few little things here and there, which is what we've done with the contract, the movies are going to be better. The shows are going to be better. The economy is going to be better. Everything's going to be better. It's going to look better. Yep. It's going to feel better. Mm-hmm. Everyone's going to be like marching to work happy. It's going to be great.
Also, it's not just Hollywood. Everybody keeps saying Hollywood this, Hollywood that, California this, California that. I need you to pay attention to most of the TV shows you've watched in the past 2 years.
Yeah.
The majority of them are not filmed here.
Right. Louisiana, New Mexico, Vancouver, North Carolina, Georgia.
Mm-hmm. All these New Orleans, all those economies are dependent upon. When the strike happened, a lot of these cities suffered immensely.
Yeah.
So it is not just well, it's just the West Coast and the California. No. This affects everybody on a different level, and it's not just actors, because the actors aren't compensated well. You saw what happened. You had prop masters who were like, I got to try to find another job.
Exactly.
People who are catering companies and things like that. It's the basis of trickle-down economics.
Oh, my God. It's the real trickle-down. Trickle up? Trickle sideways?
It's trickling. It's trickling. It's trickling. It's tricking, tricking, tricking.
That's true.
Absolutely. And again, from a content point of view, this is a win.
Yeah, this is great.
Right? They're already like, you know, a lot of these industries had a really tough time during COVID. Of course, the entire world did. A lot of them, right, coming out of that, still just kind of barely getting their footing. These strikes obviously were a giant challenge for the industry at large and the content machine. Now, let's hope everybody healthier and happier coming out of this. Right? Like, we can hit the ground running, have a great 2024. Of course, one of the reasons that people think the strike ended when it did is because, like, hey, we can still kind of get things going in 2023 and then won't have as negative an impact on next year, hopefully.
Yeah.
Right?
You believe that if you won't. Who start? Here's why. That's why, because the thing is, if you get, let's say our contract drops tomorrow, right, for SAG, and we have to ratify it, there's at least like a week period of that. So then that happens. What is next week?
Thanksgiving.
Well, 2 weeks.
Right?
2 weeks.
Then Christmas, whatever.
Yeah, we can have.
You see what I'm saying? It's like, nothing's going to like fully ramp up because of the holiday season. Now, granted, there are going to be some things that are going to push through. It's just the way it's going to work. Some things are going to push through. But Christmas to New Year's, that's done.
Mm-hmm.
Now, how soon you have people come back after New Year is a question, because you know by mid-January at the latest, things need to be going.
Yeah. Well, I mean, if we, so again, if you don't know how it works, just because we are off strike now doesn't mean that we've ratified the deal. So basically, the deal, the union sends us the contract and we vote yes or no to ratify it, to certify it, I suppose.
Mm-hmm.
So if we vote yes, then everything goes off and everything starts production and things get going. Mm-hmm. If we vote no, then we all go back to the negotiating table and that would be difficult. But, you know, I mean, it's up to the people in SAG to vote and decide for themselves, because we pay dues, which are not cheap.
No.
So
whether you're working or not.
Yes, whether you're working or not, you pay dues. So, you know. But also, again, as I said at the beginning, just because we are in the position to lead on AI is relevant to everybody else who has a face.
Mm-hmm.
So we will be the spearhead, I guess, of the legislation that gets pushed through Congress that will protect everybody. Again, you don't want to wait, like, turn on Netflix and be like, why am I the face of a hatchet murderer? Who did that? Why?
Right. Especially this face? Come on. This would make a great hatchet murderer. I got to hold back. Yeah. Evan, are there any comments in the chat? Are people bringing up questions?
Yeah, I think a lot of people have found it pretty you know, enlightening and educational. Here's one question from Jay
enlightening
Thomas.
And educational, two things we strive for every day.
Hey, if that's, you know, that's what I strive for, Zach. Jay Chavez Loeza asks, as fans, would you want to know if actors were AI in a movie? Would you still see movies or shows if there are no quote-unquote real actors? So I know we talked about this a little bit. I don't know. How do you guys feel about this? Like, do you feel like if something were to be fully AI, wouldn't that just be all... wouldn't that just be akin to animation? You know,
so even if, like, we're saying, like, Brad Pitt literally never showed up a data set, but he did consent to have his digital image AI'd throughout a movie, would that take away from your enjoyment of a Brad Pitt feature? I think so.
To me,
probably,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
There's at least where the technology's at now.
Yeah, here's why it needs to happen, though. Because then people will really see they don't want it.
Yeah, that's true.
It needs to, you know, people are going to say, well, what's the big deal? We can get all these actors AI. We don't need to have them. They're spoiled, blah, 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 blah. Okay, let's have a whole AI project.
Even
a blockbuster, if you will.
Yeah.
Just because it needs to happen so the response can be, oh, shit, we didn't need this.
I mean, everybody's top 10 films of all time includes Simone. Right? Or Final Fantasy Spirits Within, right? Like those all-time classics of cinema. Yeah, it's like, even as good as the technology's gotten, there's still an Uncanny Valley issue, like it's still not, you know,
it's very weird
only for like brief instances and in certain situations does it kind of pass well, but like, I like all of the Carrie Fisher post-mortem Star Wars appearances, I didn't really enjoy. You know, they didn't look great.
It could be better.
Yeah.
Do you want Paul Walker back in Fast and
Furious 15? Do you know how fast that will happen? That will happen so fast.
He will be back. I'm telling you.
Let's get his brother more work. Pete Walker. What's his name?
He did a great job.
He did a great job.
He did do a good work.
He was falling downstairs. Yeah. I called on him.
If you guys can speak on this, let's speak on it. But if you can't, we'll cut it out of the YouTube one. But Dano Sweets asks, please chat about the human factor. WGA and DGA got a solid definition of what a human is, but SAG did not. Do you guys have any knowledge about that? Or,
I mean, I'm less worried about it for SAG just because we are the product.
We are the product.
Yeah.
So for writing and writers in the WGA, they're not the product. The product is the writing. So they had to, distinguish between AI-generated writing and AI tools for writing. But, you know, it doesn't really matter as long as the product ends up in production. But for us, we are the product.
Your face, your voice, your body.
Everything
right?
we do.
And it's for the DGA. Y'all got to live with that decision you made.
Yeah, they're not on screen, right? It is harder to. That is well said. Yeah.
So two questions from Paul Little. Another first one, if you don't want to speak on it, we can cut it out too. But Paul Little is asking, first question, can you ask about their thoughts on Justine Bateman not being happy with the AI agreements?
Okay.
I'll let you go first.
Well, okay. So it's been addressed within SAG, and the opinion of SAG, again, that I'm speaking for literally all of SAG, we're just going to...
160,000 of us!
Ignore that part of what I'm about to say, but is that it's beneficial to have her say those things at all, and that they need to be said, and that I think she's even said that the reason she's speaking up about it is not necessarily to convince everybody to come to her side, but to make sure that actors are thinking about these things before they consent to their digital double as productions are going on and they're asked to be models for AI. So it's less, I think, and when anything goes on the internet, it becomes like, them versus them. Like, it's either or, it's binary. But it's really not. Like, it's a conversation that needs to happen. And people within SAG need to think about what she said. And the SAG leadership needs to think about what she said, because it's important that it gets to leadership, which it has.
I agree. We need to think about what she said.
Yes.
However, she went on a press tour like she was a part of this. That's the issue with the Justine Bateman thing.
Yeah.
I was advising them, no, you were just one of the other many actors who were saying the same thing. So that doesn't give you a direct advisor title.
Yeah.
You were not on a negotiating committee.
Yeah.
I hate to say it that way. So your voice in that regard, yes, you said what you said on CNN, NPR, all these other places. But when it comes to that table where it's the 17 members of the SAG NEDCOM and Carol from the AMPTP.
Yeah.
That's all that matters. So that's my issue with that. Like, stop making it seem like you were supposed to be the end all be all.
Well, and also anybody who's not in the room, it's hard to comment.
Yes. Absolutely.
Even for us, you know.
Well, absolutely. I heard an interview with Duncan Crabtree Ireland, the rep from SAG, or what's his official title?
He's the national executive chair.
Thank you. Chief negotiator.
Yes. And he had a great point because he was asked, like, how did you feel about George Clooney going out there, kind of, you know, undercutting or saying he had his own ideas? And Duncan Crabtree Ireland, who is a lawyer and a very savvy, well-spoken, smart man, said, you know what? I love it if any of our members are engaged in the process. Mm-hmm. And I even understand why George Clooney goes directly to the press. Because it's like when you've led your life as a public figure and you're used to talking to the press all the time, that's how you communicate, you know? And so maybe there's a little bit of that with Justine Bateman too, right? Like, but yeah, that that was a great question. And those are great answers.
And then last one here, I think, because I think we covered Paul's second question a little bit. Sarah Hatchadorian asks, what do each of the hosts think is the biggest win from the agreement? Obviously, there's a lot of good and still stuff to continue to be negotiated. But
say that again. Negotiated? That is a word. Don't you cut? Ryan, don't you cut it out? Don't you cut it out? No, that's a word now on an Evan shirt.
That is. I struggle with negotiated. There's a lot of weird syllables in that word. Yeah. Well, what do you think is the what part of the agreement are you most happy with?
I'll pull it back up.
I mean, I'm going to say the most obvious thing, but I do think it is the truest thing, which is AI consent, the ability to consent. Because again, having the ability to consent at all is like massive in the world globally. No matter what job you have, it's like nobody has the ability to consent right now. No one. So if we can do that for literally all of society, and I mean that, like I know it sounds hyperbolic, but it's not.
This is like the first labor agreement that has addressed this, right?
So if we can do that for all of humanity, I think it needs to be done. And also, the wage increases for the people who make the least in SAG are huge. I think it's like 11% immediately and then 4%
immediately.
After that. Yeah, so the people who you're like, oh, actors are all rich. Well, okay, there are thousands and thousands, hundreds of thousands who are not, and they are getting more money.
Yeah. For those who don't know, a SAG background actor for 12 hours of work at minimum gets $180.
Yeah. So now they're going to get more than that.
Right.
Yeah.
That's before the contract.
Yes.
I think the pay bumps are definitely because, again, it matches inflation. It matches the cost of living, which has happened everywhere. Some people's cost of living, your gas right now is $3.
Yeah.
So it's not a knock to you if you're in those areas, but it's just the truth. One of the big things to me, and I know a lot of people agree with this, self-tapes.
Listen,
there's so many.
You might have to define that for our audience.
So now, what a lot of us have to do, so we do auditions, of course. COVID changed the game, whereas we couldn't go into a lot of offices. So we were taping our auditions at home with the help of a friend or yourself doing your own voiceover. But the problem was these casting directors were asking for so much for you potentially not to get a job. There are now regulations in place that says, hey, you got 70, you don't have to rush and do 10 pages of an audition in 48 hours.
Mm-hmm.
You can actually have your sides in your hand, your paper. Because a lot of times people think, oh, you should know your lines offhand in 48 hours. I got 10 pages of paper at 9 p.m.
And other obligations.
Yeah. So those things change. The pay bumps also, and again, background, I've done background twice in my life, and I said never again.
It's a hard job. Physically grueling, mentally grueling.
Yes. Yeah. And so for them to get the increases as well as protections that they got, I think those are some of the biggest things.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's great.
Yeah.
Any other questions, Evan?
No, I think we're good.
Hell yeah. Thank you both for coming in and sharing your perspective as SAG members. This was really helpful. I learned a lot, and I appreciate you both. Okay. Hopefully everybody else learned a lot. And hopefully this, again, trickles into all the stuff we love. The people we love, and the stuff we love. We want people to be compensated for making great work in any industry.
Even in Evan's cubbyhole.
Even in Evan's cubbyhole.
Wait, but that's cute.
Evan's cubbyhole sounds
good. I was going to say Evan's heaven. Is
that's
too?
That
would make more sense if it were up. This is Evan's hell.
Evan's hell.
Get down there.
Evan's cubbyhole is cute.
Evan's cubbyhole.
Or something about being under a table. I don't know what. There's not like a term for like being under a table, but
it is.
We'll think of it. Again, keep pitching in the YouTube comments. Pitch, what should we call when Evan shows up here. What is that? The Evan Hole? The what did you say? Spevin?
Spevin.
7 seconds of Evan.
Yeah.
That's too much. That was too much. That was too far. I'm gonna walk off set.
Bonus points if it rhymes or it's alliteration or it sounds filthy. All those things are good. Thank you so much for watching. Again, if you're gonna be in LA, we'd love to see you at our live show on Thursday, November 16th. If not, hit like, hit subscribe, follow these wonderful folks on social media. Continue to enjoy all the great Breakroom content. Thank you so much for watching today, everybody.
Bye. Bye.